This is Kat from Asbury Park, New Jersey, and you are listening to the Hood Rat Recap Podcast.
Started a podcast about the best bar band in the land, man. This is the Hood Rat Recap, and we are back. We are your steady stream of the unified scene, all the news and reviews of the band that you love, we love, the half from New York and half from Minnesota. That kind of sounds like our podcast, huh, guys? Hello, everybody. This is Stage Right Mike on the mic, and I can talk hold steady all night. And when I like to talk hold steady heavy, I like to throw up the rat signal, and the Hood Rat Pack has assembled. And I see first sitting closest to me in the next time zone is the Unified Scene's very own King of Queens, Gasper. Gasper, how are you doing today?
I'm doing pretty good, Mike. But you know what? I've been trying to get people to call me Paul Bunyan.
Why is that, Gasper?
Well, because I'm big and I'm burly, and I think it might be fun to hang out with a big blue ox.
Okay, how's that turning out for you?
I mean, surprisingly enough, not so good. Not so good at all. People keep calling me Pee-wee Herman. Rest in peace.
Free Pee-wee.
I mean, poor Pee-wee's dead and has to be subjected to this Freddy Knuckles. I only wish you could be on the other side of an axe throwing ordeal. They don't get better, folks. They don't get better.
All right. That's the sound of our producer and our third mic, Kevin is whenever. How you doing, Kev?
I'm doing good, but I feel like my job as producer is in jeopardy the worse these Freddy Knuckles get. And in fact, as a little spoiler to our fans listening, we do chat with Hurricane just a little later, and she takes over the production work and relegates me to just be a guest. So that's a lot of fun. We had a really great chat with her. Before we get to that, in a few minutes, Gasper, you had a lot of hold steady activity the past couple of weeks here in New York. Why don't you fill us in on some of the stuff you got to check out?
I did. And we're going to start it off with a positive jam. You want to get into it?
Yeah, let's do it. So, Gasper, why don't you tell us about some of your recent hold steady exploits over the past couple of weeks?
Yeah, man, it's been busy. So before we started off actually with a positive jam, I wanted to give a mention about the Shine a Light music series, which the hold steady was part of, that was out at RJ Daniels, which was this awesome, like, really small bar. I actually think it might have been smaller than seeing them at 7th Street Entry, which was kind of cool. This benefits the Tommy Brule Foundation, which, Mike, I'm going to ask you to throw that in the show notes as well. It's the TommyBruleFoundation.org. They basically raise money for special needs kids, which is awesome. It's a bar out in Rockville Center, and they played a pretty amazing set, man. 25 songs, kicking off with the Feelers. Other highlights, too, One for the Cutters and Sweet Pain. It was a good set. And someone actually spoke to Tad and mentioned that it was the first time in a long time they felt like they had to win a crowd over, because not everybody out there was a whole steady fan. I would say the majority of them were, but there was quite a few people there because this was part of the charity event. And so it was almost like seeing them back in their bar band days, which was kind of cool.
Was it more like of a subdued set? I mean, it seemed like they had some different songs there because of the small setting, or?
No, they played, I mean, besides the ones I highlighted, those were highlights for me, but I mean, everything you would expect to hear, like all the major hits were played. It was a pretty solid set.
Was there confetti in the bar?
There was not confetti.
Wow. How many people would you say were at this?
I'm always so bad at this. So like RJ Daniels is set up that the stage is inside, and it's about the size of like your normal small bar. Like, 60 to 100 people, maybe, like real small. But then it's got this other outside area where there's like an outside bar, and that's where merch was, and everyone was also hanging out there. So it's a good amount of people came to the event, but probably the smallest Hold Steady show I think I've ever seen. And not a lot of Unified Scene people out there. I ran into a couple, but it was kind of like a whole new crowd. It was pretty cool.
Wow. And if memory serves, that was the kickoff for your week then, right? Because wasn't that right before Positive Jam Fest, which you also partook in?
So yeah, basically the band headed right out to Accord, New York, where they held the prelims to Positive Jam, which was basically a pool party, which I would have loved to attend. But unfortunately, I had Mountain Goat tickets. Not unfortunately, because it was a great show. But I had already booked it myself for Mountain Goat, so I did not go. But I did run into Kat and Beth and a couple of people, Kat from New Jersey and David, who, well, David didn't go to prelims, but the rest of them did. And that was a pretty cool thing in and of itself. That was a smaller set, 13 songs. But they started it off with Craig and Franz played a cover of Bruce Springsteen's Meeting Across the River, which was cool. And some of the highlights to that set, which was a more subdued set, was Perdido, Oaks, Death of a Punchline, and then The Ambassador made an appearance, which I would have loved to see that, because you don't get to see that one very often.
With Oaks, we get the two T3s.
Pretty cool. But then the next day, it was the bus ride up to Accord, New York, to check out Positive Jam, the first annual Hold Steady Festival.
So the festival was at Arrowwood Farms, which is a brewery, right? If like a farm brewery?
Yep. So basically they have a brewery on site there. Couple different type of beers that were very cool, which they kind of rebranded for the show, as they do. But really kind of cool space.
So before you get into the show, though, tell me about the bus ride. Was it like, I have this picture of like the Partridge Family bus and you guys all on it singing Hold Steady tunes like little school kids, or was that not what it was?
It's not, actually. I was a little surprised. So I kind of had the same idea in my head. It was kind of subdued. There was probably about 25 of us or so on the bus. And it was 9 o'clock in the morning, so it was a pretty quiet ride up there. And then we were all exhausted on the way back, so it was a quiet ride back. But it was very convenient. It was nice to not have to drive up there, not have to worry about getting in a car on the way back.
So there wasn't a keg on tap like in the
nothing like that. I thought about putting a cooler together, but they had sent an email out, like just kind of giving you the instructions of where to meet and all that. And they were like, "Yeah, you can feel free to bring a cooler, but it is 9 o'clock in the morning." .. And I'm like, "Yeah, I guess that's fair play." I don't know if I should start drinking in Brooklyn.
I mean, moving forward, maybe they'll hire a bartender for the future bus rides for the for the Unified Scene to partake, even if it is 9 in the morning, because yeah, good mimosa is great for any show day.
I do recommend taking the bus ride, though. It was definitely convenient, because it's a good 2.5 hours up there, so it was a decent ride. But
and then what time did it start from when you got there versus, like, because it's an all-day festival, right, at that point?
Yeah, so doors were at 12. I think it kicked off about 1 o'clock. They had a DJ between 12 and 1. But then music launched pretty much right at 1 o'clock, and it went straight through at about 9:30, which worked out nicely because, one, we're all getting old, so a 9:30 end of show isn't so bad. And then that put us back in Brooklyn about 11:30, 12 o'clock. But actually, I do want to talk about the first band that played.
Tell us about Oceanator. I know you're a big fan of them.
So, yeah, they were really cool. Oceanator is actually a stage moniker for Elise Okashami, who plays with a guitarist and a drummer. I don't think they're her regular guitarist and drummer, though. But she basically she came up in the DC punk scene, and she's definitely, you could see, into everything from, like, punk rock and like heavier stuff like that to singer-songwriter stuff, and you get this interesting combination. She had a great sound, a little heavier than I expected her to be in certain spots.
Another bad brain day. I can't seem to shake the feeling it'll always be this way. I'll never be okay.
So she's got two albums out now, Things I Never Said, which is a 2020 release, and the big song off of that one seems to be I Would Find You, which is a great song, but a little different than what she had played at the show. Not as heavy sounding, a little more synthesizer, but real, real cool sound. And then there's this shift for this 2022 release, Nothing's Ever Fine, which Craig pointed out when he introduced her, this was his favorite record of 2022. Some great tracks off of that one is Bad Brain Days. And I also really liked a song she played live called Stuck. So definitely check those out. I would kind of describe her as like a grunge, pop punk, like indie fuzz kind of sound. Reminds me a lot of like a Liz Phair, which is probably apropos because she says she draws her influences from the 90s. But we did get a chance to speak with her, and here's what she had to say. All right, so I'm here with Elise from Oceanator.
Hi.
And, you guys are the first sound to ever come out of Positive Jam. Like, how does it feel?
Oh, yeah. Good. Weird. A little floaty when we first started, but then, you know, playing a set, which is always fun, getting to play music for people. So it was super fun. Very, very, very happy to be here. Everyone was so sweet. Everyone I've talked to after has been so nice. So, yeah, just very happy.
Awesome. Yeah. And you guys were really good. Like, you really took me by surprise. Like, who would you say your influences are?
Oh, gosh. I grew up on a lot of Green Day.
Cool.
I love Elliott Smith. I like Wolf Parade. Oh, man. I always forget every band that exists when I get this question. We listened to Bully in the Car today. I love that new record a lot. You know, the 90s. The awesome. 90s are my influence.
Awesome. And where can people find your record?
It is on the internet at oceanator.bandcamp.com. or at oceanator.surf is my website. And then it's also streaming everywhere that things are streaming.
Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Oh, very cool that you got to catch up with Oceanator at the festival. And it was I'm glad you experienced it. Looking online, it looks like she has some tour dates end of September, early October on the West Coast. If any of our listeners out there want to check her out, looks like her website too is oceanator.surf, S-U-R-F. So if you want to go give a listen, go check out over there. And then what happened after Oceanator?
After Oceanator was Laura Stevenson, who is always awesome. We've heard her before. She's open for Craig, and she's open for the Hold Steady, and she's always a favorite. So she was amazing. And then I Get Wild, which we've seen them open for the Hold Steady before as well, but I got to give their lead singer some props, man. Like, so, Kev, did you see I Get Wild on the last Massive Nights?
No, I don't think that was the night I went. I remember them playing, but it wasn't the night I was able to attend.
So they're this, like, Talking Heads tribute cover band, and they go, like, full bore. Like, the lead singer does the whole white tuxedo thing, and, like, you gotta keep in mind, it was, like, nearly 90-degree weather. And this guy's dancing around doing the David Byrne thing in this white tuxedo, and I'm like, oh, man, I feel so bad for this guy. But they were great. And then Guided by Voices, which was kind of fun, because I do, admittedly, don't really know too much about Guided by Voices. I wasn't, you know, I never really listened to them much, but they were a lot of fun to see live. They definitely had a strong following at the show and great set. And then we get to the Hold Steady, which was the feature of the night.
Gaspar, before you get into that, can you just set this? I mean, it looked like a beautiful place. Kind of just set the scene to us. What? I mean, it just looked beautiful from the picture.
It was very cool. So basically, it's kind of an open field. Like, it is a farm. And they had one area that was pretty much where they were serving the beers from. It was like this wooden gazebo. And then there was, interestingly, the crowd was divided into VIP and then everybody else. But the VIP area was literally like, so if you, you know those like metal police barriers that they have? Mm-hmm. It just divided the crowd in half. So like to the right was VIP and to the left was, so basically Tad's side was VIP and Fran's side was was regular people. Mm-hmm. So I started off in the VIP area, which was fun, but I wound up just going Fran's side so I could hang out with Kat and Beth and the other Kat and David, who David came all the way in from. He is what, Cincinnati? Yeah, David, so. David came all the way in from Cincinnati for the show. So, of course, we had to go hang out with them because they are all fun people.
So, Gasper, was there any hay riding, any apple picking, any pumpkin catapults?
Nothing like that. There was these really odd, like, couple of tents set up where people were selling, like,
chill out tents?
Handmade. No, not chill out tents. Although I did forget to mention there was a chill out tent at Shine a Light, yeah. Which is what they called the outside area of the bar. Mm-hmm. But I thought that was kind of mm-hmm. cool. But they were like tents set up where they were selling like handmade bags and tchotchke stuff like that, which was kind of weird because it's not that kind of crowd. But I think they were just kind of locals that, you know, they set up for the music festival. And then you had Mosh Pit Josh and his stuff under a tent, and that was pretty much the whole setup. But it was very cool. It was kind of nice to see them in an open air, like on the grass type setup. I definitely recommend going again next year. The set was great. Of course, they started it off with a positive jab because you have to at Positive Jam Fest, and then we got Heavy Covenant, which was always a favorite, and Family Farm, which. How do you not play Family Farm at a farm? But, yeah, that's my recap of Positive Jam Fest.
Well, it sounds like Positive Jam Fest was quite the experience. Hopefully next year my schedule will allow me to attend. I was preoccupied with work, and Mike was at home, but maybe we could reconvene for next year, the three of us get together. But looking ahead now, I think it's time we should check in with our interview with Hurricane Jess. If for anybody listening who hasn't seen, there is new artwork for the Hood Rat Recap podcast, which Mike Gasper and I are extremely excited about. It's an incredible piece created by Jess herself, and we had a great conversation with her to talk about her influences, her love of the Hold Steady, how she got into art. And really, the piece she did is something special, and we're really excited to show it to everybody and talk to her about it. So, without further ado, here's our chat with Hurricane Jess.
Jesse, I'm not joking around. You're hanging with, and those kids don't seem positive. Don't all the stakes make you tired? You know I never ask you to change, I only ask you to try.
All right, so we're here with Hurricane Jess, who did an amazing art piece for us. So first of all, thank you so much for that. We really love it.
Yeah, I have to say thank you, too. We don't want to be silly of us just to let Gasper say thank you.
Thank you for letting me do it, guys. I had so much fun. I got a little bit obsessed and probably spent way too much time on it and did way more than we initially discussed, but... It was so fun. I just couldn't stop adding more and more stuff to it.
That was the amazing thing, because I think we originally said, like, yeah, we're just looking for, like, a rat in front of a microphone. And she's like, oh, I could totally do that. And then what came back was this, like, Where's Waldo of Hold Steady and podcast stuff. Like, where did you get all your – I mean, obviously you got the inspiration from the band and all that. But, like, so, like, where did that all come from? How did that come to be?
Well, I did the drawing on Photoshop, and – as you guys know, I sent you a couple of like little basic pencil sketches of the ideas that I had. And it was just a rat stood in front of a microphone. But I also had that idea of the rat being stood below a drain with diamonds falling down through the drain because of diamonds in the drain. and just that concept of the lighting coming through the drain. I don't know why, but that just sparked this whole concept of, well, if there's a rat in a drain, then maybe that's the guys from the podcast, like, den. And if they did have a den, what would be in the den? And what would fall through the drain? What random bits and bobs related to the lyrics would end up down there in the gutter? And it just kind of got crazy from there, really. You know, so it started with like cigarette butts and, well, diamonds, dice. And then I also wanted to take like parts of your guys' personality from the podcast in there, which is why you've got Gasper with his crown and playing cards and the dice and the poker chips, and then Mike with the crown and the lift a puller hoodie, and then Kevin, you've got, well, I decided to add Dwight's pipe and your hoodie and headphones since you're like the producer, and it, you know, it just grew and grew and grew. Like every time I drew one thing, I wanted to add another thing in, and I was listening to the whole study and Lift a Puller the entire time, and every time I heard a lyric, I would write it down. So I have this massive list of things that I... And I didn't even add them all in. Like, I was thinking, I'm literally going to do this for the rest of my life if I add everything in that I'm going to do. But yeah, I had to pull myself back at some point and say, I should probably, you know, finish this. But yeah, that's basically what happened.
So how many Easter eggs would you say are hidden within the picture, approximately?
I don't know, like 40 maybe? If you count each individual pin on the map, which all correspond to places. Yeah, there's a lot going on. And also each item might have multiple references. And yeah, it all just got a bit out of hand.
Well, we've talked about doing a contest around the poster and how many of the listeners can figure it out. And I almost feel like we are not adequate to judge the winner, that you're going to have to work to do it. Because I'm going to laugh if somebody says something that we don't have in our anti key, and you're like, oh yeah, I meant to do that, but I forgot to tell you. And then we're just at a loss.
Yeah, well, I actually wrote a list the other day because I was thinking, I need to know what the heck I've done here because I don't even know. And I started writing it, and half of the time I was like, why have I done this again? Like, where's this pin pointing to? And like, there are so many, obviously I'm not American, so I'm thinking, where is this pin pointing to? Like in St. Paul, I can't remember. Is it like Regent's Hospital or like, what is it? I don't know. But yeah, so... I'm actually a little bit frightened that someone's going to be looking at it and like, this pin points nowhere. I know what you're talking about.
Yeah, it's a picture with a deep storyline. And it's really, like you said, obsessive, which is perfect for our podcast because we're very obsessive about this stuff. And everybody, I think we have it as our new show art. As you're watching this, you can go and check it out and you can see all the detail that what we're talking about on this picture. It's great.
We're also going to post it on the socials so you guys can see it and have something to work off of. And I think Mike's going to post in the show notes the speak pipe. And so I think the way the contest is going to run is, what do we decide on? 10 references or as many as they can come up with? Or what do we want to go with?
I think we should base it on who gets the most right, honestly. And,
yeah,
you know, that's how you're going to be able... Because if we get 5 with 10, it could be the tie. This will help with the tie factor, unless everyone gets everyone, which... I haven't gotten everyone yet, so.
Yeah, I don't even think I could win it, yeah.
I feel like people should get more points for the more obscure ones. So, like, if two people get 10, but one of them gets, you know, one that I've forgotten, or, you know, like, some of them are, like, really buried in there. Like, you can't see unless you really zoom in. So, you know, I'm very excited.
We're going to have to let Jess be a judge on this one. But we'll post it on the socials. Michael post the speak pipe. And if you guys can call in and just give us as many references as you could find, we have 5 posters to give away and we'll send them out to you. So that should be some fun. So how did you start drawing like this? Like you're very talented. Like is this something you do professionally? Is this a hobby?
So it is kind of like what I do for work. So I did an architecture degree and I work in an architectural practice now, and I'm a 3D artist, so I mainly do more modeling and doing, you know, photorealism visualizations of buildings. But what really started this was when I first went to see the Hold Steady and was completely blown away and immediately obsessed, like all of us. I decided to do a poster, and I love the Weekender posters, the style, the colors, and so I did my own one, imagining that they had done a Weekender in 2008 when Stay Positive had just been released. And I did a Mustang, and it had like a satellite dish on the back of it and a cat, and a subpoena. Wow. And it was all like stay positive kind of references. It was simple, but it was just something I did for fun. And I thought, hey, I'm going to post this on the Facebook group. And everyone was like, oh my God, this is so cool. Like, are you going to sell them? I want one. Props for using the right Mustang for the year and blah, 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 blah. And I was just like, oh, cool. People really enjoy this. And, you know, it was fun. And I loved doing it. So that was the first whole steady piece of artwork I did. And then the weekend just gone this year, I wanted to create something for like my close unified scene buddies. And so I did them each a drawing in the same style based on their favorite Hold Steady track. Then I got t-shirts printed with that art on for them just for fun, as like a little like, oh my God, it's like the Hold Steady holiday of the year for us, like kind of like Christmas, you know. And again, like that was so rewarding and I enjoyed doing it so much. And they, you know, were really excited about it. And yeah, and I suppose that's kind of where it all started. And then I reached out to you guys and here we are.
Well, it's funny when you brought up first talking about the poster, and it was like, we didn't know what we wanted with the poster because we hadn't even talked about it as a podcast. So when you like, oh, I think I went overboard, you know, we didn't really have a level. So like what you came up with is actually one of the greatest pieces I've seen. And I've known people that have done Hold Steady fan art. We've talked about it internally. And like when this piece came up, I don't think any one of the three of us were not just so impressed by it. And, you know, seeing how your mind took what we talk about and created this visual based on voices, we had never seen each other. We hadn't talked until even this podcast. And it's really impressive how talented you are. And I can say that from someone that works with artists all the time. This is really something special. And so in your mind, when you got started, and like we just talked about the hood rat with a microphone, which was kind of just the basic concept of what we were looking for, at what point did it like, because you did actually make one too, people may not realize, there is a standalone rat with a microphone that is drawn, but that kind of was like the original idea, and then you came to this. How did, at what point in your mind were you like, I'm just going to keep going?
So I did do, I actually have post-its here to show you because I thought you guys would get a kick out of it. At work one day when I was thinking about it, I did some like tiny, tiny sketches on post-it notes. And I, wait, where's my camera? And this is the solo rat under the drainpipe one. Hopefully we'll find a way to attach this so people know what we're talking about.
Right. Yeah, we're going to have to post these like maybe on the socials or something. But
like into Instagram so people can see them. But that's, you'll just have to send her shots. That's
just
pretty
to
wild.
Just describe to what she's showing is there's the hand-drawn rat with the microphone. And then there's already all these little arrows with like, this is a reference to this. And this is a reference to that. There's like six of them on this little
It's like a Venn diagram.
Yeah, so there's like a little, the basics, you know, there had to be diamonds and dice and a hoodie and obviously a rat and a microphone. But then I did this other drawing and for some reason the Last Supper painting came into my mind, and I was thinking, obviously biblically, there's so many biblical references. I don't know if I must have been listening to Separation Sunday or something, but I was thinking about, I drew this rat in the middle first, obviously with the halo.
I was going to say, now I know why Mike has a halo.
Yeah.
Well, he's got a halo because he's from St. Paul.
Right.
Yeah,
well,
exactly. Yeah.
And I just have a halo in my natural life.
Right, because I see it now. It has nothing to do with where you're doing this recording.
Yeah.
Wow. So, yeah, and then I loved that idea and the whole biblical aspect. And I thought it would be so fun to have the three of you as characters. And then, so I think I did those and I sent you the little sketches, right? And they were the two options. And you guys said, can we combine them? Which is then what we did. And then I was just having so much fun. You know, I was just drawing it and I was thinking, I can't believe, like, I'm doing this. It's so fun. And I kept just having more and more ideas and just, I don't know what happened. It just happened. And suddenly we ended up with this craziness. And also, this isn't a style that I've drawn before. Like, it's kind of a strange, like there's photos, there's like a photo composite aspect, but then there's line work and sketching, and It's just a strange drawing, really, isn't it? But
I mean, the funny thing is, even the bill that's folded up on the record could be like your future in counterfeiting, and because it looks in this that it could almost be like a real bill folded up in this anime kind of design.
Well, it's $40, you know.
I was gonna say, do you get the reference? Do you get the Hold Steady reference, Kev?
I didn't know they were 20, so now I know.
$40 and her favorite band.
She can draw American money better than I can, yeah.
Yeah, that is one of my favorites, so I had to get that in there.
Yeah, I love that one too.
Yeah. See, it's good that we're giving away little Easter eggs for the people listening, because they're going to be like, now I see it in case they missed that one.
Yeah. The more you zoom in, the more there is, like, it is, I just did get very carried away, but I hope everyone enjoys it, like, looking at it as much as I did making it.
Yeah, I like how you said the word fun, like you had so much fun, because when you look at the picture, that's the emotion I get. It's just a fun picture, so much to dive into, so much detail, just funny and detailed at the same time. Very good.
I'm so excited you guys like it.
So why don't we get into a little bit of, like, how did you come into the Hold Steady? Like, how did you first start listening to them?
So this is the same story as Mike from Roanoke. So I grew up, like, I was like a tomboy and a skater girl and all this kind of stuff. And I was obsessed with all the Tony Hawk games. But my era of Tony Hawk games was actually Project 8. And as a lot of people know, Hood Rat's on that soundtrack. And wow. So I literally grew up from whenever it came out. I think, was it 2007 or 2008, listening every time that song came on, I would repeat it because you could repeat it in the game. So I would just be playing the game and, like, repeating that song over and over and over again. And then that continued until I was a teenager, or I think I was probably like 20. I had the sense to actually figure out who wrote this awesome song. It's still one of my favorites. I played on repeat. And then, yeah, I listened to Separation Sunday and I just couldn't stop listening to it. I feel like I still remember hearing Hornets for the first time and thinking, oh my God, why has it taken me so long to listen to the rest of their songs? Because this is a banger. And Hornets is still one of my absolute favorites. Every time I hear the first part, I literally get so hyped up. But yeah, and then that was it. No looking back. And then I saw they were coming to London. Had no idea about what a massive scene it was and what community it was. And then went to the Weekender for a night, and that was that. Now, like, it's a whole massive family.
Are you going to the Weekender this year?
Oh yeah, I can't miss that. Nothing can get in the way of the Weekender. That's like blocked out.
So I know you said you did drawings for friends and whatnot. So how many times have you combined both of those talents? But, you know, both this piece maybe being the latest. But is that something you've done often since you've been a fan? Have you found yourself sketching Hold Steady references besides what you make? Have you heard a song and be like, I'm going to do a drawing based on that, and there's a artwork of Hurricane Jess inspired by the Hold Steady book in your pocket?
I've got so many ideas, like, knocking around in my head that I want to get down on paper, but just, like, too many to even list. But I was thinking it would be so funny to do a Nassau Coliseum Valentine's Day card.
Oh, cool.
Wow.
You guys know what would be on it. Or at least on the front of it and then inside it. I don't think anyone would buy it except maybe like you three. But I was also thinking, a bit like one of you guys said, you described this poster like a Where's Wally? Or sorry, you guys call it Where's Waldo, right? Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But we call it Where's Wally, and I was thinking, having done this, I kind of want to do it again, but on a bigger scale. I was thinking it'd be hilarious to do a Where's Holly, and maybe do like a street scene with people walking around and different, you know, shop fronts. Like, I've got all the characters, all the all of the references, all of the places, the venues, everything.
It would have to be on East 13th,
right? Yeah, I mean, exactly. But I
don't give away before she's done it, because people are going to know where to look.
Yeah, I would absolutely love to do that. I just this project was so fun and so rewarding. I just want to do another one. But yeah, so that's definitely on my hit list. I would love to do some more stuff like that.
Awesome.
I think that's really incredible. This all came from a Tony Hawk video game. The way you take cross medium, like it's an audio medium, you know, the whole steady, and then you turn it into a visual medium. I mean, I guess it kind of makes sense.
Right.
A video game is a different medium. And I think it's just amazing that how you're so good at transcribing them into a different medium.
Totally.
Is your love of video games how you got into your love of sort of 3D animation? And kind of, is that what put you on the path being a gamer and seeing how, like, those worlds are built? Or, like, did you always know this was what you wanted to do?
I definitely think it's played a massive part. Like, Mirror's Edge is one of my favorite games. Mm. And I remember playing that when it came out. Again, I think I was 8. And just thinking how amazing that was. And it's so basic, but, you know, the world, it's all about the world because, you know, you're doing parkour. Anyway, I'm not going to go into games, but but yeah, architecture, I don't know. I've always been arty, but I feel like most people who get into architecture are artistic people who are too scared to just be artists.
Yeah.
You know, like go like hard into the, I'm going to be an artist and live off my craft. It's more of a like, I better do something practical with this. But thankfully I've been able to, yeah, do architecture and now get into this more artistic and less building control, planning regulations aspect of architecture, which I love.
So, like, will there one day be a building somewhere with, like, the infinity symbol on it or something?
I don't think so, but there might be a game with a building with the infinity symbol on. I would love to get into, you know, games and film. Wow. Environment design. That would be the dream.
Awesome.
But yeah.
So getting back to the Hood Rat recap poster, what was the sort of one Easter egg that you were like the most excited about hiding?
That's a good question.
And I'm going to ask a personal question because I don't even know. Looking at it, is the graffiti above the lighter, is that HRF or is that HRR? I want to know if it's Hood Rat recap or Hood Rat friend.
I'm like looking at it now.
And it's behind my back and it's in my world, so I want to know.
It's recap podcast and then the T is hidden behind the wave. I mean, the nothing. I don't know what that is. Nobody.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I didn't see if it was an F or a P. So I was trying to see if it was Hood Rat friend or Hood Rat recap podcast.
It's THRP.
Cool. Nice.
Okay. There you go. Now I know. It's one more for me on my
on your hit.
Where's Wally? I'm in.
I'm still thinking about that last question because that was a really good one. I did really enjoy trying to find all the pins that and put them in the right places. I don't know if I was 1,000,000,000% successful. I don't want to give away my favorite ones because I want people to have to figure it out.
Can you give a hint?
I mean, you could give one because there's plenty in there. Personally, like, if you were to name one, and out of all the people that listen to it, if they got it because you gave it, it's like the middle square in bingo. And then you got to get the other ones.
Well, the one thing I will mention is that there is my imaginary non-existent business card on the table.
Oh, cool.
Which I thought was kind of fun. Because I realized I'd done this piece of artwork and I hadn't signed it.
Oh, wow.
And I was like, that's kind of strange. Like, I feel like I should be in there somehow. So
yeah.
I did do a little kind of very vague business card. And then also one of the newspaper clippings is from Hurricane Jim.
Awesome.
So I got my there little signature in there. You know.
I just keep looking over my left shoulder here because it's hanging in my office. So I'm like looking
so
for all
cool.
this stuff.
I love that it's in your office. So exciting.
It's the wallpaper on my second screen, so I can look at it. So that's what I'm doing. I'm like turning my head, staring at it.
I love that. Yeah, I've got a place. Jack White's currently in my poster above my desk, but I'm afraid he's going to get replaced by my own poster.
That's on its way out too. Yeah, I don't know how long it takes to ship something from the States to you guys, but It's on its way.
Thank you. Oh, I can't wait. I'm so excited.
All right. So thanks again for this amazing piece of art. It was a lot of fun talking about it. And if you guys could just please check out our social media, the Facebook, the Instagram. We're going to post this picture up there. It'll be up there for you to check out and see how many Easter eggs you could find. And Mike will have the SpeakPipe link in the show notes. Just click on that, head over to SpeakPipe, and leave us as many Easter eggs as you can find, as well as your name and address. And if we pick you, we will send you out a poster. We have about 5 of them to give away. So it's really awesome, and we think you guys are really going to like it.
And don't post the answers on the Facebook group. Like, let everybody do their own homework. And we're going to have Jess herself actually rate everyone's responses. So do your best.
I can't wait to see what everyone gets.
All right, so we like to ask our guests to tell us about a band they think that Hold Steady fans should know about, or that kind of sounds like the Hold Steady, and we like to call this From the Meatloaf to the Billy Joel, so we're going to have Jess do one for us.
And the Meatloaf to the Billy Joel. Certain songs, they get so scratched into our souls.
So, yeah, I don't know if this is one... This isn't really a band that sound like them, but I feel like you guys would... or the scene would be into them. They're not very well known. They've just got signed to Third Man Records recently and released their first self-titled album. And I saw them open for Jack White, I think, last year, and they were really, really, really good. They're called Island of Love. And especially the title track on their new album, Big Whale, it's called. I really love that. I'm loving that at the moment.
Now, what kind of stuff are they?
It's kind of like grungy. I don't even know how to describe them. You're going to have to listen to them and tell me what you think. So you might be like, oh my God.
Yeah. Well, if they opened up for the White Stripes, they're probably, yeah.
But yeah, I definitely recommend giving them a listen. It's really good.
Awesome. Now, besides the title track, is there another song you like off the record?
I love it all, to be honest. I like I've Got the Secret as well. Really good. Like, it's just one of those, you know, you can listen to it all the way through and it all just flows, and yeah, it's great.
Got it. And now, if this is a Third Man artist, this is one that Jack White would have discovered? And
maybe. They're based in London, so I don't know if it would have been him personally or just, you know, the Third Man Records team, but
gotcha.
Yeah,
awesome.
All right, I'm looking forward to listening to that.
Cool. Yeah, give it a listen. It's really good.
Cool. Above my majesty, above that fruited plain, there were diamonds
in the drain. It's that time for the Diamonds in the Drain game. Yay. So, you know, we've been working on this for a while, guys, and we're only 6/10 of the way through. So I think we're going to get 2 more done today. And for those of you that can't remember, we roll a D&D dice. We all know D&D stands for Diamonds in the Drain. It's a 10-sided D&D dice. And because those three albums, Thrashing Through the Passion, Open Door Policy, and The Price of Progress all have 10 songs, so we're going to roll it, and we're going to give a gold, silver, and bronze medal. No ties allowed, and that's what makes the game so difficult. So, Gaspar, do you have our vaunted D&D dice?
I do. It's the metal one.
A metal one, okay.
Very excited.
Not a heavy metal one, just a metal.
Not a heavy metal one, just a regular metal one. All right, here we go. Okay. And we have our first double. It's a 2.
Sorry, not one.
Reroll.
We had done track two the first week ever.
All right, so. And that's a one.
Yay!
Wow.
Okay. There you go. All right, so only one.
All right, so track one. So you know what that means? That looks like I'm assigned Thrashing Through the Passion, and we all know track one is the infamous Denver haircut.
Shaved his head at the airport in a bar at the end of the concourse. Said you're kind of catching me at a transitional time. I'm a bright light burning into a dark horse.
Whoop, whoop.
Nice. Okay, and open door policy will be the feelers.
Hard one.
That's what makes it fun, Jess.
And number one on the Price of Progress is Grand Junction.
No joke, this is going to be a hard one. All right.
I think this is probably the hardest one of all of them. On these albums.
Especially since two of them are Denver songs.
Yeah.
Or Colorado songs, I shouldn't say Denver songs.
All right, well, Jess, as the guest, you have the honor of going first.
Oh, man.
I'm glad we let her go first.
I'm going to need some time and to talk this through. Mm-hmm. And to call some people, you know?
Call some phone
we
a
haven't
friend.
Had a phone a friend yet.
You're going to phone a friend?
Yeah. Oh, I just love all of these so much. I can feel my blood pressure rising.
I'm kind of nervous for you. I'm not going to lie.
I know she likes drawing the Spaceman poster because that's also in her artwork. Yeah.
That's true.
From the Feelers.
I think I'm going to have to give the Feelers bronze.
Wow. Okay.
I can't believe I'm saying this. I never thought those words come out of my mouth, guys. But I do love it. But I just love the other two more. Like, Denver Haircut is one of my favorites. And Grand Junction has also that, you know, we've heard it live recently. It's still got that new magical feeling. So, but now I have to choose between Grand Junction and Denver Haircut. I'm going to give Grand Junction silver. Because as much as I love it, and like I do, like I said, it's got that shiny new, we've just heard it live and it feels really special. And the music video is the London Weekend videos.
That's
and
right.
I'm in it loads of times.
Oh.
But it just tells you how much I love Denver Haircut. Denver is on my phone case for that exact reason.
Wow.
Yeah. So that's my answers.
So what is it about Denver Haircut that makes that your top song?
It just does not get old. Every time I hear it, I'm like, yes, this is a banger. Turn it up. Accidentally start driving way too quickly. You know, it's just, yeah, it's just, I love it. It's so good. And it's such a good opening track. I think it's, for that album, it's just, it sums up the energy, like the high energy, like bounciness is what I always associate with Thrashing Through the Passion. And I mean, I'm out of breath just talking about it. Need I say more?
This game's supposed to be fun, Jess. She was hyperventilating.
She's like, can I get an oxygen tank, please?
Need okay. A stiff drink after that, guys.
Mm-hmm. All right, well, we still have another round, so save yourself.
All right, so then...
Mike's up.
Why do I have to be up? You know, of course, we say the same thing. I agree with Jess, and we always say this. All three songs are awesome. I'm going to put the Feelers at bronze just because Open Door Policy was getting all golds, and now lately we've gotten a couple bronzes to Open Doors. Things are starting to turn around a little bit. So I'm going to give it the bronze. I love that song. I know some people are down on it being kind of a slower song for starting out the album, but I really enjoy the storyline. The Spaceman line is really one of my favorites. Then for silver, I think I'm going to go, this is tough out of the two Colorado songs, but I think I'm going to give Denver Haircut the silver. Sorry, Jess. It's, you know, that opening line's just crusher killer. Awesome. Just very cool tune. But something about Grand Junction is just, it's just so grand in scope. It's just a big song. I just love the big sweeping music, the big sweeping sky vistas that I think about when I hear the song and hear the music. So, yeah, so I'm going to go Grand Junction with Gold.
All right. Wow.
Good answer.
Not to say I'm copying both of you, but I agree that out of the three, the Feelers is my bronze. Kind of for all the reasons said, it's a little slower. And when you put it up against these other two songs, it's hard to compare. I love The Price of Progress. Everyone knows that. But I am giving Grand Junction the silver on this one because I'm giving Denver Haircut the gold. Only because as a guy that was just at Metallica last weekend, there's a Master of Puppets reference in Denver Haircut.
Ooh.
And that always stood out to me in that one song. So thanks to Metallica, Denver Haircut gets the gold.
All right.
That comes to you, G.
So, all right. So what makes this so hard, in addition to these being three great songs, is these are three very visual songs, right? Like, they're also descriptive and picturesque in their own way. The way Denver Haircut describes everything, the way that Grand Junction is that big, like Mike was saying, those sweeping melodies that, like, just you could almost picture those skies. And yeah. So
this sounds like you're stalling.
I am, because I really like the Feelers. I really do. But I think it does get the bronze. I'm sorry.
Ooh, four bronzes. For our beloved Open Door Policy.
Heather's going to hate me because she loves that record. And like we get into arguments at home about the stuff we do. Mm-hmm. But The Feelers gets the bronze. And as much as I really love Denver Haircut, I think it gets the silver because I really love Grand Junction. Especially hearing it live, like, it's such a tremendous song. So yeah, I'm gonna go with that as the gold.
Wow.
So what does that do to the numbers, Kev?
Well, it's interesting.
It's a draw, isn't it?
It is. Look at Jess. Look, she's not only good at drawing, she's really good at math.
Well, I'm only good, like, at math if the whole study is involved. Like,
thank
Kevin
God my
and
toes
pies
are out, because I was counting to 10 twice, so I had toes included. So, but you had that right away. So as Jess adequately and correctly stated, Denver Haircut and Grand Junction are tied at 10, with the Feelers comfortably, which I guess you could maybe say is silver if we're tied for gold on this one, with a 4. So maybe that's almost the way we fix it, is because now it's a tie. Denver Haircut and Grand Junction are gold. And then you could just say, you know, the Feelers is silver.
It's no secret that, because this tie happened once before, and it's when we do add the guest in. So we do keep separate numbers just so that we know where the three of us are. So where does it land with our normal count, Kev?
Okay, so in the normal count, then Grand Junction gets the edge by a point.
I wonder why you wanted to know that, Gaspar.
Because it doesn't help you with your wife, though. You still put Open Door Policy last, so good luck with
still
the couch.
In the doghouse.
Right. But in terms of what you're saying, yes, if we just did the host count, Grand Junction is gold, Denver Haircut is silver, and the Feelers is still bronze.
8. Okay. So, Mike, what do you have for 8?
Track 8 off Thrashing Through the Passion is also named after a Margot Hemingway, is that her name, movie? Star 18. Hemingway, a cafe select. Town of summer in the discotheque. Once you get good,
you can get wherever you are. But that's a really good pull.
Mario Hemingway. I don't know what her name is.
Star.
Mario, but she has a sister. She has a sister, too.
All right, for Open Door Policy, it is Riptown. This kid's a computer that's been programmed to dream. He stumbled to start, but regained his speed. He said, my superpower is I say what I mean. And he's always in the red.
And for The Price of Progress, it's Perdido.
Ooh, interesting.
Oh. Mm-hmm.
She was twisting in the bucket seats and switching through the stations on the radio.
And we're going to make our get, we're going to torture Jess. She's already hyperventilating. Let's torture her some more. Jess, you go first. She's giving me the middle finger, I think.
Oh, man.
I personally am going to have an easier time with this one.
I agree.
Wait, I think you guys should go first.
That's not how the game is played, special guest. Look, she's trying to produce the show. I think you guys should go. I'm the new producer. The hell would you?
Kevin, why didn't you make the poster, okay? And I'll just
produce
it.
Yeah, wait till you see. I'll show you my post-it notes.
Nobody wants to see that.
Note to self, don't invite Jess back. Oh, man. Okay, I'm just writing notes here. Okay, I think I made a decision. So I'm going to give Rip Town bronze.
You okay? There's no wrong or right answer. That's.
I know you say that, but it feels like there is a wrong answer and they're all wrong.
It's like you're choosing between children is what
yes,
it is.
Yeah, yeah. And, okay. And I think I'm going to give Perdido second. I mean, silver. Which, you know, saying it aloud in a British accent just doesn't sound right. I don't think I've ever heard someone say that word in an English accent before.
Perdido?
Perdido. I don't know what that was either.
That
yeah.
was an American accent there.
And then, yeah. No, I don't want
to say in a Minnesota accent.
And that means Starry Teens in Gold.
Okay.
But I'm not even convinced by my own answer, to be honest. And I can't even give you any reasons why. This is just Starry. I think I knew Starry Teen would be in first, but I wasn't sure about the other two. That was tough.
All right. Mike, you're up.
Okay. So this one, yeah, a little bit easier. Rip Town. You know, the more I hear it, the more I like it. I'm kind of getting into it. But like I said, out of these 30 songs, it probably comes in, you know, 28, 29, 30, somewhere around there for me. So that's the bronze. And then silver, you know, Star 18, that's another song that really grew on me. At first, I was like kind of confused why they included it in the album and they cut some of the other songs out. But then now when I heard them play it live and they were doing the guitars, Steve and Tad were mirroring each other on different sides of the stage. I really like it a lot. It's a good song. And then for Gold, that leaves Perdido. That's just such a hidden gem. That song is, I love that song. I think it really has the signature sound of the new album. And wow, I love that song so much. It gives me goosebumps. That's all I got to say.
Well, it's weird because Star 18 and Rip Town to me personally are sort of close to each other. So it's kind of a coin flip personally, but I am going to go, like you all, Rip Town bronze. I am like you, Mike. I'm putting Star 18 silver and Perdido gold because since we've talked about The Price of Progress, Perdido is one of my favorite songs. Getting to hear it live was, you know, just incredible. And it still hangs true as that late song anchor for me on The Price of Progress. So that makes it my gold.
Yeah, I think that was when we were talking Price of Progress episode. I thought that was your favorite song on there or something.
It was. So, yeah. That, you know.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's rare that me and Kevin agree. But when we do, we do. I kind of got to go the same way. So Rip Town, if I'm being honest, is kind of a skippable song for me. I'm not crazy about it. Can't love them all. Star 18 is one of my more favorite songs on Thrashing to the Passion. I love when they have self-references. I love that line, the, you know, Hold Steady at the Comfort Inn, Mick Jagger at the Mandolin. Like, it's, I just like it. But Perdido is really a stellar song off that record. It's probably one of the best, and I'd be hard-pressed to not put it in first. So I'm going to agree with Kevin.
Which is also agreeing with Mike, and it's a first since we've been doing this that all three hosts have had the same ranking.
Ah, there you go. So,
Jess, the producer, is the outlier on this one.
And that's why I'm the producer. So,
just in case everybody was curious, it would have almost been a clean sweep had you not produced the wrong way.
I feel like this is a dangerous comment, but Perdido is just not one of my favorites at all. And to be honest, neither is Star 18, but I love that line, the way I make plans, you got to take it with a grain of salt. It just, every time I hear it, it just makes me giggle a little bit, and I'm like, okay.
That's what makes this fun, because like, you see it in the Hold Steady Positive Posting group. Like, there's the arguments that go back and forth about who likes what song, and each song hits everybody differently. But there really is something for everybody.
Yeah.
So it makes it fun. All right, Kev, what's the math say?
So hold on. Let me get into the math, and I will let you all know. So in terms of album totals, this was a tough week for Open Door Policy. At this point now, the total for Open Door Policy is 45. The total right now for The Price of Progress after this week is 55.
Okay.
And the total for Thrashing Through the Passions right now with their new 13 more points puts it at 44 total. So after this week, The Price of Progress is clearly ahead. Open Door Policy is second at 45.
Wow.
And Thrashing Through the Passions is third.
Open Door 44. Was winning the whole.
Interesting. Still a close race, though.
It's close. And the last two songs could really change everything. But as of right now, on these three albums, based on our game reactions and whatnot, and this is just the three of our scores. Sorry, Jess.
Do you mean the three of our scores?
The Price of Progress is.
The artist.
Right, I'm sorry. Yeah. Shit. You know what? Let me readjust that. You're right. If I take myself out as and you produce, the numbers are way better for
it
Thrashing
would be
Through
because
the Passions. Thanks to your Star 18 love.
Thrashing is awesome. I love Thrashing. I see so much hate for, not hate, but disinterest for it on the Facebook group, and it makes me sad. Like Craig saying that Teeth Dreams is a child that he'll never, that will never come out of the basement or whatever. He said, justice for Teeth Dreams.
But that's the thing, though. Like, it goes.
That's your hashtag. That'll be your next poster.
Yeah,
justice
for
Teeth
Dreams.
It goes in waves, though. Like, you see that happen, and that's definitely like there is that attitude about Teeth Dreams and the different records. But then songs like Oak Surface or songs like The Ambassadors to a Focus, and people love them. So, like, I don't know. I don't think it's quite the bastard stepchild that they make it out to be.
I mean, it's also due to the roll of the dice this week that really helped it, because The Price of Progress had Perdido and Grand Junction.
True.
That's what came up.
Bangers.
So those are both, for all of us, very high score songs, especially for the podcast crew, as you know, Jess, as the producer. So, that really put The Price of Progress over this week. But there's still two more songs to go.
And one of them is when I first thought of this game was one of the tracks that's left that's going to be, I think, one of the most contentious, even though they've all been contentious. I think it's going to be very contentious. Yeah.
All
right. Cool.
So, little
Which
preview.
One?
I mean, if you really wanted to figure out, we could just say what the next two songs are.
Right.
Honestly,
can't remember what.
There's only two left.
There's only 10 songs, and there's only two left, everybody.
Yeah, we might not even have to roll the dice next time.
Yeah. Ooh, so off of Open Door Policy, what's left is Lanyards and Heavy Covenant. So that'll be rough.
Mm. Hold on, I got to see what's left on. What do we have?
Three and six is left.
Three and six. Oh, yeah. So we have Carlos is Crying and the Bird Watchers.
Mm-hmm. And we got You Did Good Kid and Entitlement Crew.
Ooh.
Oh, my God.
Oh, man.
Okay. Well,
I can't wait to hear the verdict.
I know. I already know where that one's going.
Stay tuned.
Stay tuned.
It's going to be some heated arguments next.
Jess, if you want, you could produce that segment too and just.
Okay. Sounds good. You can do the artwork.
I will. I'll show you my post-it soon.
All right. So that's going to be Diamonds in the Drain. Jess, thanks so much for playing with us. This was awesome. Mm-hmm. And was there anything you wanted to promote or how people could get in touch with you, maybe see some of your artwork, or where can they find you?
Yeah, that would be awesome. I mean, I'm pretty active on the Facebook group, and so anyone can contact me through there. It's probably the easiest way to find me. Or I'm also on Instagram. I've got a few different accounts for various things, so it'd probably be easiest just to attach those links below. But yeah, I'm up for anything. Love to do any artwork of any kind.
Awesome.
So yeah.
I mean, if anybody out there needs a custom drawing, you can't go wrong with anything Jess is going to do. Her creativity is really impressive, as you can see in the stuff we're going to post. And if you go on her socials and see her other work, there's a reason she does what she does, because she's really good at it.
Aw, thanks, guys.
And you can send me the $40 from the table for that plug.
Fully entertained, he's bleaching out the bloodstains. He's got diamonds in the drain. She said that she was coming, but she mostly just made hard, fast noises.
All right, that was a lot of fun and a great round of diamonds in the drain. Thanks to Jess for helping us with that. Just one quick recap in case everybody missed it or just tuning in late, which you're late to the show because we're getting ready to get out of here. The price of progress is our gold right now with 55. Open door policy is silver with 45. And thrashing through the passions is bronze at 44. But that's a lock to change. As we get ready to get out of here, we did reach out to the Unified Scene and ask anybody or our listeners to report if they got to check out any of the Empty Bottle Show that both Mike and Gasper and myself couldn't make. And we got a very in-depth and great recap from our very own Andrew from Australia. So why don't we give a quick listen to that right now.
Hey there, it's Andrew from Australia here. I heard your call out for someone who went to the Empty Bottle in Chicago. But I'll tell you what, I went there and I can do one better because I went to Louisville as well a couple of nights before the Chicago trip. So my tour to America was inspired partly by the when I did the podcast with you guys earlier in the year, and I realized it was going to cross over with the Chicago street race for NASCAR, which I really wanted to get to. So it sort of sealed the deal, and I made my trip, my 28-hour flight combination to get to Nashville for a NASCAR race there, down to Charlotte, where I just missed seeing Weezer by a couple of days, which was a bit shattering. I had quite a few of those ones where I missed people by a day or two. And then all a bunch of others were over in England or Europe at the time. So people like some Spanish Love Songs, who I'm seeing in 3 weeks' time down here in Melbourne. But Louisville was great because I went there to do a bit of a Muhammad Ali pilgrimage, and there was the Hold Steady playing a free show in the park. I went for a bit over an hour, I think about an hour and 15 minutes. Had a country and western band, the Watson Twins, play before it, and I noticed Craig standing by the side of the stage, eagerly watching on with his bit of his country influence that he gets into his solo albums. But it was a great little set list. They started out with Hornet Hornets, Stuck Between the Stations, and they did Adderall Magazine, Sideways Skull to open up, which was terrific, and then Sequestered in Memphis. So they did Family Farm, but they were originally planned to do You Did Good Kid. So I've got the set list from the show, and I've got it marked out in Texter for Family Farm, which is a song I really love, actually, followed by Entitlement Crew, which is also really good. And then, of course, we rounded out with all the classics, you know, the Chips Ahoy, Constructive Summer, Carlos is Crying, which is terrific live, Hoodrat Friend, and, Massive Nights Into Stay Positive and Killer Party. So really good little set list for a short show. Intro, of course, just because we all like to know what the intro was Smoke on the Water. And big crowd, probably about, I don't know, maybe 4,000 or 5,000 people in the park there, and everybody, I think, enjoyed it. And certainly the people around me, some of who'd never seen the Hold Steady, were really into it, and made some great comments afterwards. But then, of course, you know, it was from there up to Chicago, and we did the two Salt Shed nights. I got to meet 2/3 of the recap, which was really good, and a couple of two really great sets. But then, of course, the Empty Bottle, which was, they called it a dive bar, which is not an expression we use much in Australia. So I was kind of wondering what a dive bar was. And Dave, who looks after them on the road, said it was a bit like the Corner Hotel in Melbourne. Let me tell you, it's nothing like the Corner Hotel in Melbourne. The Corner Hotel in Melbourne is a palace. Compared to the Empty Bottle. But the Empty Bottle had such a cracking vibe. I mean, weird little place with a stage in the corner and an L shape in front of it. By the time I got there, I was a little bit late because the NASCAR race had gone a little bit late, and because our local boy Shane Van Gisbergen won the race, I had to stay around for that, which was a bit of a bummer. So I missed the first, you know, handful of songs. So I came in and song number six, which was the Entitlement Crew. So I'd missed out on Positive Jam, Cattle and the Creeping Things, Same Kooks, Sequestered, and On With the Business. And from there, it just went nuts. Like, it was a small bar, about 300 people. and just a great vibe and a cracking set. I'm not used to standing down the back of the shows, but you got a really different feel of the way it all works, which was good. Really good to feel it from a different spot. But that said, you know, we compare it to the crowds here in Melbourne. I mean, if you'd gone to the Corner Hotel last year, which was an amazing show, and then the Corner Hotel, you know, 10 years or so beforehand, which Craig still says is the best show the whole city's ever played. But the Melbourne crowds are quite different to the Chicago crowds. And let me tell you, Chicago seemed tired last night. Anyway, from there, we got a couple of newbies, so Fly Over Halftime and Heavy Covenant, and a few others strapped in there. Obviously, Sideways Skull, which is going to become a standard, I would think, on their shows. And rounded out the opening part of the set with Most People Are DJs, which is my go-to song. It's my happy song. I can't listen to that song and not feel good afterwards. So, loved that part of it. we got Modesto, He's Not That Sweet in the Encore, which was great. Obviously, Stay Positive with Mosh Pit Josh, and then round out with Killer Party. So big show, great vibe. Hung around afterwards, had a chat to Steve afterwards, and found out he's a big NASCAR and drag racing fan. So hopefully when they come down to Australia next year, I'll be able to show them a bit of our car racing stuff and do a few other things there. So the Empty Bottle. Great show, different vibe, completely different vibe to the big shows at the Salt Shed, but a lot of fun anyway. Best part for me was getting to meet some people from the unified scene, had a good chat to some people after the Salt Shed shows. I met a bloke called Kevin who's probably going to be a lifelong mate of mine from here on in. He was terrific. He took me off to a 4th of July party. We went through this place to his favourite little bar near him, which is called the Old Town Ale House, which is an amazing little bar with lots of paintings on the wall that the original owner's done of all the famous people and things that have gone through the place. So overall, I rounded out my trip to America with the Empty Bottle and of course, the 4th of July, fireworks and stuff. But now I'm just sitting back and waiting because I hear the Hold Steady's coming to Melbourne in May next year. So for anybody who really wants to come down and see the Hold Steady play in a place where the best crowds in the world exist, start saving because the flights aren't cheap. What is it, about 20 hours to get here from most parts in America? So it's a bit of a trip, but well and truly worth it. So that's it. That's the Empty Bottle for me. The show, just kicked. It was great. As I say, very different vibe to the Salt Shed because it was smaller and crowded and, there was a body on body contact everywhere. I had to protect my backpack with all my computer and camera gear in it. The confetti just went all around the place. It wasn't just at the front of the stage. It was absolutely everywhere throughout. And best of all, I got to have some of that big deep dish pizza afterwards. Anyway, that's it for me. Enjoy the rest of the podcast, and we will chat soon, no doubt. Bye.
All right, and that was Andrew, as doing it as Andrew from Australia can, just recapping those shows, his American trip for us. And so as we're getting out of here, folks, I just want to remind everybody, we got that new, with Jess's poster, our new logo, there's a bunch of Easter eggs in it, a bunch of references to the Hold Steady. So on our show notes, I left a link to SpeakPipe. You just go on there, click it, read off all the Easter eggs you find. Whoever gets the most will get, what are we going to do, Gasper? We're going to send them a poster.
So, Jess is going to be our judge. And if you get a bunch of Easter eggs right and she picks you, we're going to send you a poster of the artwork. And it's really cool. I have one hanging in my own office, actually. And we all have one, and we'd like to give you one, too.
Yeah, so make sure you just leave your email. It should give us your email anyway, so we can contact you and get your address to get that sent out to you. And speaking of the show notes, we got a bunch of stuff in there. Gasper, why don't you tell them what we have listed in there?
Yeah, so make sure to check out. We're going to have Jess's Instagram up there. She's got some cool art to check out as well on that. And I did once again want to plug the TommyBruhlFoundation.org. Please check that out in the show notes. That's the organization that runs Shine a Light Music Series, which raises money for special needs kids.
And that's going to bring us to the end. And as always, if you like what you hear on the Hood Rat Recap, tell a friend. We appreciate you all listening. Go to our socials. Give us a like. Give us a follow. This episode was great. As we stated earlier, we can't thank Jess enough for the amazing artwork. Can't wait to see how many of the hidden clues you all get. I don't even think we've found them all yet. That's why we're having Jess do the grading, because she knows. And even she admitted, but as you heard, that she gave a few away. So... once again, give us a like and a follow, and we thank you all for giving a listen. Of course, it's we do this because of you. That support is what keeps us going. So thanks all for listening, and Gasper, take us out.
All right. Well, I'm Gasper. That's Mike. That's Kevin. That was Hurricane Jess. And us guys and all you guys and gals, we are all the Hood Rat Recap Podcast. The killer party songs show.
Free Pee-wee.